Hello, everyone, and welcome to the program. I'm Kevin Hensel. We're very happy you could be here today. And we have the opportunity to talk to State Representative Rob Matzie. Thanks for joining us.
Good to be with you, Kevin, as always.
We're going to try to talk about a lot today, including some health care issues and some unemployment compensation. I know it's important to a lot of people throughout Pennsylvania. But let's begin with an issue that dominated most of 2009, and that is the Pennsylvania state budget. It took a long time to get there, but what did you think of the final agreement?
Well, as a freshman member, obviously disappointed that it took 101 days to get to a final version of a budget that we could pass. But I said in February when we looked at revenue numbers that we needed to be focused on a priority-driven, people-first budget that really focused on policy and not politics. And I think we strayed at times, obviously, and I think that's what really led to the impasse of 101 days. Couple that with so many new members in the last two sessions of the House. I think that a lot of folks came in to the House reform-minded, with more questions than in previous years. And I think oftentimes that we saw in the House, and even in the Senate for that matter, that stuff was rubber-stamped. Relative to the budget and other issues relative to the legislative process. And that hasn't been the case. As a freshman, I have to say that my voice was heard. I spoke up many times in caucus and on the floor, as did many other members of the freshman and sophomore class. So our voices were heard, and we really stood strong relative to being against broad-based taxes. I know that was very important for my district and my folks that I represent. They spoke loud and clear that personal income tax and or a sales tax with the economy that we're in today just was not an option. And I'm proud to say that we stood up, many members from southwestern Pennsylvania as well as throughout the Commonwealth, saying to our leadership and to the governor that there's no way that we can support that. So we got to a budget finally, and I think that we took care of some core we focused on some core functions of government, specifically education, taking care of the most vulnerable, the elderly, and as well as some pre-K count money, which was very important with the education component. And I think that, you know, we focused real hard as far as a House caucus, Democratic caucus, on education. And I think we really carried the torch for that, and I'm proud to say that we got that through.
You mentioned there's no broad-based taxes in this budget. The proposal to add a tax to a lot of volunteer fire departments, that was removed. But also, I think by adding more money for education, you were able to prevent possible property tax increases on the local level. And I know that was important.
Absolutely, no question about it. And I think, really, when you explained that to the public, they were like, wow, we didn't think of it that way. But it's true. If we did not get to the point where we did with the budget for education, there's no question about it that property taxes would have gone up for some folks in their individual districts, and they would have saw it when their tax bill came out in August. So that was very important. And you mentioned the tax on the volunteer fire departments as well as some of the other nonprofits and social clubs. That was a non-starter. Same with the museums. It just made no sense, the zoos, et cetera. No sense to me, and I think we were heard loud and clear say that was a non-starter. We can't even go there.
Well, obviously, we know the state had a $3 billion deficit to start with. So in order to balance the budget, there had to be some painful cuts. I know there were some that you dislike a lot.
No question. The EITC was a tough one. There were some versions of the budget that totally eliminated the earned income tax credit. Fortunately, we were able to get some of that back into the budget. Library funding, initially, there was talk of cuts of over 50%, which would have potentially closed libraries in my district, got it to 34% and eventually to 21%. And the PHMC and the Pennsylvania Historical Museum Commission was really a tough one for me because I have the first ever state museum site in my district across the street from my district office in my hometown of Ambridge. So Old Economy Village suffered 9 furloughs, and they're going to hope to rely and work with the volunteer group that's charged with supporting the site to keep the site open in some capacity. And that's really been a main focus of mine over the course of the last couple of months since the budget finally passed, was to find a way to work with this. I've reached out to the governor, the administration, his staff, as well as leadership and all members of the General Assembly on both sides, as well as the PHMC, the volunteer groups, and other groups within the region to step up to the plate and find a way and come up with a plan to keep this valuable site open. It's 6 acres with 22 buildings, 17 original buildings, and it's in the middle of town. And we can't see this site closed to the public. We have to find a way to keep it open, and I invite folks to check them out on the web. Go to my website and sign a petition to get your name out there so we can let the governor know how important this site is to you. 30,000 visitors a year come to the site, school-age kids for field trips, etc. It's a regional asset, and it's something that needs to stay open.
Well, throughout the budget process, we saw the public can make a difference in shaping policy. This is an example for people to do that. And we should probably point out that when you voted for the budget, this was not one of the options that you knew about.
Absolutely. I think people need to understand Old Economy Village does not have a line item in the budget. They're part of the PHMC budget. PHMC's budget was cut drastically. And they had to make tough decisions, furloughs as well as site closures potentially. And I think that, you know, their hands were tied at PHMC in a lot of ways. But there was no reach out to us from the administration relative to what could happen if the budget gets to this point. The House Democratic version of the budget was cut. The budget that we eventually passed was compromised. It was part of the whole process, and it was cut more than we had hoped in the beginning. But again, we had no idea. I was caught with a jab to the belly, just like the public was, relative to the potential for closing as well as the large number of furloughs.
Yeah. Well, certainly the legislature provides the money, but it's up to the governor's administration how they spend the money on things. Well, the budget was a source of a lot of concern throughout the year. There is some good news. You mentioned earlier that the budget should put people first. Well, you have some legislation concerning health care that does that. Can you talk a little bit about
question.
It?
No question. We were able to get the mini-COBRA bill passed, which was very important. The governor did sign the bill, put it into action. Federal stimulus dollars stepped up and helped pick up the premium relative to the employer's contribution to allow folks that work for a small business with less than 20 employees be eligible if, in fact, they were laid off and lost their positions. Another option relative to health care. So that was important, and I think that folks realized how important that bill was on both sides of the aisle, and we were able to come to a quick conclusion, get that done, and get it into the governor's hands for a signature.
As the legislature moves forward, is health care going to be an area where you continue to try to find ways to improve? We know it's happening on the national level, but there's work that still needs to be done on the state level as well.
No question. I think that we can't wait for the federal government to get things done and get their house in order, so to speak. I think that's really taken over the landscape of all the television news programs in the evening. And we need to still focus on what's important for the Commonwealth and the residents that we serve. So if that means we have to go and come up with some good, strong policy relative to health care, then so be it. We will attack it. We're prepared and we're ready to go.
Look, we know COBRA is a great program for people who perhaps lose their job. Obviously, unemployment is a big concern all over Pennsylvania, especially western Pennsylvania. There is some good news also for unemployment benefits for people.
No question. And fortunately, in southwestern Pennsylvania, we haven't been hit as hard as other parts of the Commonwealth and or the nation, quite frankly, relative to the percentages of unemployed. But extensions have been granted on two occasions by the federal government, up to 99 weeks for some folks, that they will be eligible for unemployment compensation. So I think that's important. We need to show the public that, yes, as policymakers, we understand you're hurting. The economy is tough. You may have lost your job to no fault of your own, but we need to be prepared and ready to go to come up with programs to help you get over the tough times. And hopefully the unemployment compensation will get you to that point. You can get into another position or potentially get called back to your old job.
And certainly it can be a little bit confusing. There's a lot of different versions of unemployment out there, different extensions that take place for different when you lost your job and how long you've had it. So it's a good idea for people to try to get information from the Department of Labor and call those 1-800 numbers that they have.
No question, because it's a federal and state process, so you really have to look at both of them. And obviously, we'll help try and get you through the maze if you have any questions in our district office. And if we don't have the answer, we'll find the answer for you.
All right. Well, we're just about out of time, but we want to say thank you for State Representative Rob Matzie for joining us, and thank all of you for watching this edition of Legislative Journal.